coming to the house, God's house. Man. And he lets me in here. That's what's amazing. I know he'd let Brother Bill in here, but he let me in here too.
Yeah, but I come with special invitation.
There you go. Yeah. There you go. Praise God Almighty. Let's go before the Lord. Thank you so much, Father, for your word, Lord God, that you give to us, that you have written us a letter.
If I turn that on, you can hear me better.
That you have written us a letter, Father God, that we can come and study your word and see what you are saying to us today, Father. Thank you for bringing each and every one of us here today, that we can come and see what your word says to us, Father. Open our eyes to see what you're saying, what you're showing us today, Lord God. Open our ears to hear clearly from you, Father, and that your name be glorified above all. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. This world is a tough world to live in, amen. It's not an easy place to live. I hadn't found anyone yet that's got it too cushy. Even, you know, a lot of times, us poor folks, anyway, we'll think all those people with all the millions of dollars have got everything that they could possibly need, but we find out that they have problems too. They end up committing suicide and all that sort of stuff, so they can't have it that great. They end up having all sorts of divorces. They get married 10 or 15 times and all that sort of stuff. So just dawned on me, we have one young one here. Would you like to take him and go back and enjoy some time together? We got some special things we're coming up for Easter. So come and be a part of that. Bring your young ones, and she's got some special stuff put together for that. But this world is tough. We need to make sure we know what the Word of God has to say to us and know His plan for us and His love for us and the way He has made special provision for us, for me and for you. He has made special provision that we can live in peace and joy on this earth. Even in the midst of the craziness, we can have that peace that goes beyond all understanding, even in the midst of the craziness that goes on. But God Almighty has put so many things in His Word to show us the way. We can't possibly miss it, but far too often we read through His Word and forget, we don't realize that there's a lesson there. It's not just history. These are historical happenings, especially in the Old Testament. They were historical happenings. They were things that had actually happened, and they're writing this stuff down. Now we get to look at it from this side of the cross and through His Holy Spirit to see what it really means. He was teaching us something there. So we're going to start this morning. We're going to go back and see what Jesus had to say. And if I can get that to go. There you go. Jesus said in John 5:39, He says, "You search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And these they are which testify of me." That Jesus is saying that the Old Testament, the Scriptures, what Scriptures did they have then? They had the Old Testament. They had the entire book of the Old Testament. And He's saying, yeah, you're searching the Scriptures. You're doing good because you think in them you have eternal life. But that it's the Scriptures that testify of Jesus. And we have so many different patterns and types and shadows we see in the Old Testament that point us straight to Jesus. But far too often we just breeze by and say, that's a very interesting story. That's very nice. I'd like to hear that story again. But they are all there for a reason. Types and shadows. We have many types and shadows of Jesus in the Old Testament, pointing us to His salvation. And we find there are many, many of them. Moses was a very good picture, if you will, of Jesus. And we have another one we're going to look into today, Joseph. Remember Joseph with his coat of many colors and everything, right? He was born in 1915 B.C. Caught you there, Brendan. Yeah, I'm not that dumb, but no. That's some 3,900 years ago. 3,900 years ago. Almost 4,000 years has passed since Joseph has been on this earth. And yet we see an amazing story that we have there. There we go. In Genesis 37, 3 through 4, it says, "Now Israel loved Joseph," Israel being Jacob, "loved Joseph more than all his children." Now that can be a kind of scary thing if you've got children, if you're loving one more than the other. "But because he was the son of his old age, he also made him a tunic or a coat of many colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him." Boy, now that sounds kind of interesting, doesn't it? If we're looking at and comparing this to Jesus, we see also that God has given him a special linen garment, right? His holiness, his purity, that he set him apart to where you could see, look at Jesus and see the glory of God upon him, and he would be standing out apart from everybody else. But just like the Old Testament prophets came and presented Jesus to them, and they hated him because they did not want to hear that the Messiah was going to come and judge them and point out their sin. So they hated him because the Father loved him, but the people rejected him. All throughout the Old Testament, we see how the prophets were rejected and despised by the people that were sent to. And so praise God, he is there, still loving, still carrying out. So we see in Matthew 3:17, "And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.'" We see that the Father loved Jacob, loved Joseph, and now we see in the New Testament that the voice, the Heavenly Father, saying, "This is my Son, in whom I am well pleased." Joseph, the name Joseph means to add or to increase, and to increase more and more, to add. Isn't that an interesting name, to add? What a name to name your son. That's a good name to have, though. An adder and not a subtractor, right? In John 10:10 says, "The thief," Jesus is speaking here, "the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly." See, Satan is a subtractor. Satan is a subtractor. He wants to come and steal everything you've got. Steal your joy. Steal your victory. Steal your peace.
Amen.
Steal everything that you've got. Steal your relationships. Steal your family away. Steal your health away by making us in bondage to different things that are so easily available in today's society. We have everything from prescription drugs to illegal drugs to alcohol to tobacco and everything else in the world that harms our bodies. And he comes to steal our health away and everything else. He wants to kill us. This is his main objective. He wants to kill us. And he does a good job of that a lot of times. And a lot of times he gets our cooperation in doing that, right? We do things and we shoot ourselves in the foot. But he is there to subtract, and he wants to destroy everything that you have. He wants to destroy your life and everything that's around it. But Jesus came that we may have life. Doesn't that sound kind of like an adding, to give you more abundant life, to add? See how that matches what Joseph's name is, how he's an adder. He's adding more and more and more, increase more and more. So that shows us right there, we've got such an amazing Savior in our God that he has come to set us free from sin and death. Genesis 37:2, back to Joseph. This is the history of Jacob. Joseph being 17 years old. This is interesting. 17. That's a young guy, right? My granddaughter is 17, Ariel. She's about to turn 18 here in a couple of months, so it's she's getting up there. But being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father. Now, does that sound like he's ratting them out? Kind of sounds like he's ratting them out, doesn't it? But I don't think it is. His dad didn't come and jump all over him for saying anything. He was going and telling his father the truth of what's going on with his brothers. Hey, Dad, my brothers are in trouble. They're in all kinds of doing crazy stuff and stuff like that. Doesn't that sound kind of like what was happening to us? Amen? But no one wants to hear the truth, right? We don't want to hear the truth about our own lives. But, and that's one of the reasons why they hated him, because he spoke the truth about what was going on in their lives. But Joseph would go and tell his father what was really happening. So his dad was listening and paying attention to what he was doing. There we go. Genesis 37, 5 through 8 says, "Now Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more." Boy, this guy can't win for losing, right? They hated him even more because he had a dream. Now here's what he said. "So he said to them, 'Please hear this dream which I have dreamed. There we were binding sheaves in the field, all of them, him and his brothers, right? Then behold, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And indeed your sheaves stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf.'" Now if we're comparing this to Jesus, what happens when they crucify someone? They lay him down, right, and nail him to the cross, and they kind of stand that thing up, right? "And then behold, my sheaf arose and stood upright, and all of them bowed down to it." Ah, sounds a lot like a cross, doesn't it? But what do they do? "And his brother said to him, 'Shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us?' So they hated him even more." Man, poor guy. They hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. For his words. They didn't want to hear the word that they were going to be in subjection to someone else. And we find the same exact thing happening in the Old Testament, when the prophets would come and point out their sin, and they hated them, and they would murder them. They would kill each and every one of them that was sent to them. Everyone got murdered. Isaiah, you would think that Isaiah would be so revered. He's one of the most, he is the major prophet of the whole Bible, the one with the biggest book and the amazing prophecies and everything else. You would think that he would have been loved by the people, but he wasn't. They saw him in half with a wooden saw. Now, if you're going to saw me in half, at least make it a nice sharp saw, right? But a wooden saw, come on. They hated this guy, and it's the same thing that we see here. "You're going to reign over us. You're not going to reign over us." John 15, 24 says, "If I had not done among them the works which no one else did, they would have had no sin. But now they have seen and also hated both me and my Father." They saw what Jesus was doing, and they hated him even more. And when you hate the Son, you hate the Father as well. So many people will say, "Hey, I'm okay with the Father. I know there's a God out there, but this Jesus, I reject him. I don't want to hear anything about it." And I've heard people say that. I've seen them put it on Facebook that, "This Jesus thing, I'm all right with God," because they make their own God. They make up their own one to fit their own wants and desires and needs, someone that isn't going to make them feel uncomfortable. My God just is simply a loving God, and there is no judgment in there. There is no sin or anything like that. And they like that. But this Jesus said that the Father has placed him in charge of all judgment, right? He has given him all judgment. They don't want to hear that judgment part. But they know. But when you reject Jesus, you reject the Father. Philippians 2:10 says that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth. Everyone will bow their knee to the name of Jesus. Nero will bow the knee to the name of Jesus. Hitler will bow the knee to the name of Jesus. And you see what happened when Joseph told his dream. They said, "Oh no, we're not going to bow the knee. We're going to bow the knee to you? I don't think so. We're not going to do that." What did they do when Jesus came? They did the same thing. "We're not going to bow the knee to you. We're going to kill you just like we've done every other prophet. Isn't that amazing? But they just, that's what they were up to. That's what they were all about. We're going to kill you the same way. They would not bow the knee. But praise God, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess. Oops, back, there we go. Genesis 37:13 says, and Israel said to Joseph, listen to this. Are not your brothers feeding the flock in Shechem? Come, I will send you to them. So he said to him, here I am. Here I am. Now, again, if we're comparing Joseph to Jesus, here's the father saying, your brothers are feeding the flock in Shechem. Shechem means, looking it up, and the old Hebrew says, is called the place of burdens. Here's the father saying to his son, your brothers are in a place of burden. I'm going to send you to them. Does that sound anything like the Father God sending his son Jesus? Your brothers are in a place of burden. I'm going to send you there because I know you'll go and speak the truth. Just like when it sounded like he had ratted his brothers out. No, he's there speaking the truth. I'm going to send you to your brothers in bondage and bring them back. So, and Jesus' answer, here I am. Whatever you want me to do, I'm at your disposal. Just like we've talked about so often, it's not about what I want to do. Well, that's inconvenient. I was going to watch my favorite show this afternoon on TV. I can't go right now. Or it's going to be hot out there. I don't want to go out there in that heat. It's dusty out there. I don't want to do that. I was going to make a big meal today. I was going to go out to eat it at Chili's. I can't do that, Dad. No. Here I am. Whatever you want me to do. And this was a pretty good journey. These guys didn't have to jump in his Lexus and run over there in a nice air-conditioned car. He was going to walk, right? Amen. But he was going to send them to his brothers that were in burden. Genesis 37:18 says, now when they saw him afar off, even before he came near them, they conspired against him to kill him. Again, we go back to the prophets that were speaking of Jesus. They saw him from afar off, hundreds if not a thousand or more years in advance. And they had already made the decision that they were going to kill him when he got here. And what did they do? They saw him when he came and they killed him. They plotted against him. They put it in their heart even before he came near them. Isn't that interesting how the Word puts all this together? Now, how many times have we read this over? And I'd say, well, I know Joseph is a major type and shadow or a picture of Jesus. But when you really start looking at all the details that are in there, and I've said so many times that the details that are in the Word of God that we pass over, without giving it a second thought, we miss so much that the Lord God has put in there. It's amazing that he is there. And they conspired against him to kill him. They all got together. Wasn't just one of them said, hey, I'm going to go shoot him. No. They all conspired together. Let's get rid of him. And they did this in advance. Luke 19:14 says, but the citizens hated him. Man, this is a Jesus they're talking about. The citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we will not have this man to reign over us. Sound like his brothers? Same words. You're going to reign over us? We will not have this man, Jesus, reign over us. Same exact things. Isn't that amazing? To me, I don't know, maybe it's just me, but I think it's pretty cool. Well, pretty bad, actually. Matthew 26:3-4. We see what happens with Jesus. Then the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders of the people assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and plotted to take Jesus by trickery and killing. Amazing how the similarities are. When they saw Jesus, they knew who he was. They knew who he was. And they plotted to kill him, just like his brothers conspired against him. There we go. Back to Genesis 37:23 about Joseph. So it came to pass, When Joseph had come to his brothers, that they stripped Joseph of his tunic, the tunic of many colors that was on him. Matthew 27:28 says, and they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. They took off his clothes, stripped him, to make him humiliated as possibly as they could get, stripped him of everything he had, and nailed him to the cross while they threw their brother in a pit. So Judah said to his brothers, Judah said to his brothers, what profit is there if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? What profit? Isn't that interesting what a way to put that? What a way to put that. Come and let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother in our flesh. And his brothers listened. His brothers listened to him. You know what the name Judah means in the Greek? Is Judas. Judas. Isn't that kind of, what profit is there? Come let us sell him. Didn't Judas kind of have his money in the change purse all the time? He kept the money. He was the treasurer of the group. And he kept stealing money. And what did he do? He turned him over to the... By the way, let not our hands be upon him. The Jews turned Jesus over to the Romans to do the dirty work. They wouldn't go and murder him. They wouldn't kill him. We can't. We don't have the authority to do that. It's up to the Romans to do that. So they sold him to the Gentiles. Same thing that the Jews did to Jesus. Same exact thing. Matthew 26:14-15 says, then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, what are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you? What are you going to give me? I want some money here. And they counted out to him 30 pieces of silver. Isn't that amazing? Same things. What profit is there if we touch him? But we won't do it. We're not. We're too good to do that. Genesis 37:31. So they took Joseph's tunic, killed a kid of the goats, and dipped the tunic in the blood. A kid of the goats. What do you call a kid of a goat? It's like a lamb, isn't it? Kind of like a lamb. And they took and sprinkled the blood on that coat of many colors and brought it to dear old dad to see. What would they do with the blood? That they would kill the sacrificial lamb in the temple? They would kill it and they would sprinkle the blood. They would bring it before the Father and sprinkle it on the mercy seat. They would bring the blood of the lamb before the throne, before the mercy seat, and sprinkle it before God. Genesis 40:41. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you. Now Joseph has been raised up. They sold him to the Ishmaelites. They put him into captivity. They moved him into the prison and everything else. Now God has raised him up out of all that. And he has said there will be, get this, there will be 7 years of famine in the land. Isn't that interesting? He told the king. The king had this very disturbing dream. And he says, I can interpret that dream for you. And he says, this is what's going to happen. There will be 7 years of extreme famine in the land. And I know what to do to get you through it. Now, this is the interesting part. This is the beautiful part of what God Almighty in his provision for his people has done in advance. This is amazing a part that now we see that he goes from the prison and now he's going to be raised up, and you shall be over all my house and all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Jesus said all authority has been given to him in all heaven and earth. Amen? Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you. Whereas Jesus, he's at the right hand of the Father. Father's still number one. Jesus is at his right hand. Only in the throne is he greater, is the Father greater. 1 Peter 3:22 says, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him. Our Father has put it in His Word, showing us very clearly. And it says in Genesis 41, 45, He was given a new name. Savior of the world is His new name that He gave to Joseph. That the Egyptians called Him the Savior of the world. Revelation 19, 12 says Jesus was given a new name. Also that no one knew, written upon His leg, that no one knew. Joseph was given a Gentile bride, given the bride of the daughter of the king of Egypt, the Pharaoh. And Jesus also has a bride, a Gentile bride. We are that bride. Amen. Amen. We are the bride of Christ, and we're Gentiles. The vast majority of God's people, the Jewish people, have rejected Jesus as their Lord. Now He has a Gentile bride, just as Joseph was given a Gentile bride. Amen? Isn't that amazing? See, we look over too many of these details as we go. Ooh. So when all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread. Listen to this one. They went and they cried out. Now if we're comparing this to God, the Father and the Son, they cried out to God, "Oh Lord, feed us. Feed us, feed us." What happens when we get into a world of hurt? We go to the Father, "Oh Lord, help me, help me, help me." That's what everyone does. We saw it again after 9/11. Everyone come crying to God, "Oh my goodness, what's happened? Help me, help me, help me." What's He say? Then Pharaoh said to all the Egyptians, "Go to Joseph. Go to Joseph and do whatever he says to do." Whatever he tells you to do, you do it. Does that sound kind of like Jesus? The Father comes. I remember when I got saved, when I came, the Lord set me free. He set me free, and I didn't know anything. I was a bad Catholic. All you say, I was a good Catholic. I wasn't a good Catholic. I was a bad Catholic. I didn't know anything about the salvation message. Amen? And I was saying, "Oh, Father, thank you for setting me free. Thank you, God, for setting me free." And He said, and it just blew my mind. He said, "Don't thank me. Thank Jesus." I thought, "What? What are you talking about, thank Jesus?" I said, "Lord, you got Moses and you got David and some of these other, and you got Jesus." You know, I didn't know anything. But what did He say? Go to Jesus. Go to Jesus. And whatever He says for you to do, do it. Whatever He tells you to do, do it.
And I just say, thank you, Jesus.
Yeah?
Every knee shall bow.
Every knee shall bow. My knee bowed once I figured out. Go to Jesus. You want me to help you, the Father says. If we need help from the Father, He's going to point us right to the Son that He made the provision for, that He came and said, go to Him. And whatever He tells you to do, you do that. Be in submission to Him. But He had said that there's 7 years of famine. Isn't that interesting? How long is the tribulation for? 7 years? Oh, okay, yeah. And there's already 2 years have passed. And five more. When they came, when his brothers came to Joseph, came to Egypt to buy food, the famine had been going on for 2 years. And he says there's five more years left. We find in Revelation, the book of Revelation, not too far into it, all of a sudden, the 144,000 Jewish evangelists comes out. And he sends his people out. They wake up. They say, "Oh my goodness, he's the one. He's our Messiah after all this. He's our Messiah." And they go out telling everyone. They go out and spread the word. Yes, Pat, did you?
Yeah, I'm just reading that. Forgive me. But it says, then Pharaoh, representative of God,
right,
said to all the Egyptians, representative of the world,
yep,
go to Joseph, representative of Jesus.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's exactly what it says. Isn't that phenomenal? How many times have we read over that and just passed it right on by? We don't stop and think about this is there for a reason. These are historical facts. But that's exactly what it says. But about not too far into the book of Revelation, we see where the Jews wake up and say, oh my goodness, we forgot our Messiah. He was here. We missed him. It's Jesus. And God sends out all the people. Saying, come to Jesus.
Whatever he says, do.
Whatever he says, do. Amen. Now, Joseph was governor over all the land. Jesus said, all authority has been given to him to earth, on earth, right? And in heaven. And it was he who sold it to all the people of the land. You didn't get anything. You got no blessings unless you went to Jesus. I'm sorry, Joseph. Same thing, amen? And Joseph's brothers came and bowed down before him with their faces to the earth. Oh, well, we will not bow down to you. What did they do? But see, they didn't know who he was. They did not recognize him. They did not recognize who he was. As a matter of fact, so Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. Just like Jesus knows all the Jewish people, but they didn't recognize him. Amen. He knew me before I gave my life to him, but I didn't recognize him. When the Father said to me, don't thank me, thank Jesus, I had no idea who he was. But I knew that if Almighty God says, go to Jesus, then I better go to him. He knows better than me. He has a plan. He has this thing worked out. If I do it according to his plan and to his way of doing things rather than to my own big brain, people on this earth today want to lump God as God. As he is just God Almighty, right? But they don't realize he sent his son to give up as a sacrifice because I sinned. Because I messed up. And he gave his son willingly, opened it up for anyone and everyone. Jews didn't recognize him, still don't recognize him today. And he spoke harshly to them. He spoke, if you read through the scriptures here, it says when he spoke to his brothers there, when Joseph spoke to his brothers, he spoke harshly to them. Kind of like when the prophets would come in the Old Testament and they spoke, hey, guess what? You're in sin. And they didn't want to hear it, did they? He spoke harshly to them. And by now, he is 30 years old instead of 17. So we've got, 13 years later. 13 years have passed, and this little 17-year-old clean-faced boy probably now got a beard and everything else. But look at what happened. Genesis 42:21. This is beautiful. Then they said to one another, this is the brother speaking. We are truly guilty concerning our brother, for we saw the anguish of his soul when he pleaded with us, and we would not hear. Therefore, this distress has come upon us. Joseph says, you didn't come here for food, you came as spies. And started really raking them over the coals and treating them harshly. And talking to them roughly because he wanted them to come to this point. They had to see their sin. They had to see their sin. Far too often in today's world, the number one, they don't want to talk about sin. There is no sin according to the world today. You can do anything and there is no sin. It's okay. If you're whatever, you can be anything except a Christian, and there is no sin. Fornication, adultery, doesn't matter, whatever it is, it's okay. There is no sin. But you see, Jesus says you've got to have repentance before there's any salvation. There is no salvation without conviction of our sin. And far too often, and it's an awesome song, and it's very, very true, just as I am. Just as I am, I come to thee, or whatever it is. But we have to have that conviction of sin. And they realized, oh my goodness, we done messed up. Same thing that happened to me. Same thing that happened to me, like Brother Bill said so many times. We're to be witnesses. We're to be witnesses. This is what happened to me. When I come and I said, oh boy, I got myself in so much of a mess, I can't get out. I did it. Did you see those other guys? No. I did it. I sinned. I messed up. And I've gotten myself into a pickle worse than I can possibly imagine, and I can't get myself out of it. Just like they said, we are guilty concerning our brother. They thought they killed him. They left him in there. They sold him into slavery. First, they threw him in the pit. And his brother comes along and says, wait a minute, we got to make some money off this guy anyway. Just like good old Judah. And we saw the anguish of his soul when he pleaded with us, and we would not hear. Isn't that amazing? Therefore, this distress has come upon us. We did this. We brought this on ourselves. We caused this. There, now, their heart has changed. They have gone from hating their brother, and they had no idea that that was their brother there talking so harshly to them, that they had to come before him humbly and say, please give us food. And he, let's see what Joseph does. Joseph has been talking harshly to him and everything. Look back up, there we go. And Joseph finally says, it's me. I'm Joseph. I'm your brother. I am Joseph. And they froze. They just froze. They had no idea what to do. They were freaked out. They were scared. Would you be scared if you thought you killed your brother? You treated him that badly, threw him into prison, and now all of a sudden, here he is, the one that you've got to come to. When I came to the Lord, I knew I had no business coming before a holy God because I was an unholy man. I was an unholy man. I had committed every sin you could possibly dream of, and I knew that I had no right coming before a holy God. But I knew I had no other place I could go. And what he did was open his arms and say, come. What's he say? Joseph said to his brothers, please come near to me. They were frightened, but he said, come to me. And then he said, I'm Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. So they came near to him. Again, it applies to each and every one of us, but also is going to apply to the Jewish nation when they wake up. And he's saying, I'm Joseph, your brother. I'm Jesus, your brother. I'm the one that you sold into slavery. I'm the one you murdered and crucified. Come to me. And they're going to come. And he's going to say, I'm he that liveth that was dead. Amen.
Amen.
I'm he that liveth that was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and of death. I'm he that liveth that was dead. Praise God Almighty. But they're going to recognize Jesus. He's going to reveal himself to them. Just like he revealed himself to me and to you. Just like he has revealed himself to the world. They are going to realize it. And he goes and tells them, this is amazing. Now, here are these guys that treated him badly from as far back as he could remember. Right? They couldn't speak nice to him at all. They were always in his case, always saying horrible things, always treating him badly. Again, we go back to the prophets. They killed every one of them. Same thing. Rejected him. If you're rejecting his prophets and rejecting his words, remember it said that they didn't like his words? They hated him for his words? They hated him because of the word of God. But he still loved them. He still got his arms wide open. Praise God Almighty. He says, don't worry. Don't be concerned. I know what happened. But don't feel bad about it. Because what you did for bad, what you intended for evil, God meant for good. God has placed me in this place. God put me here so I could be a sacrifice for you. God put me here so I could take care of you. God put me here to save the world from the famine. He came to save me out of my mess, amen, as I got myself into a mess. We still do it. We still do it. Is anyone perfect here?
No.
Not me. We still do it. We still shoot ourselves in the foot. Where do we go? Right to Him. Oh, Lord Jesus, forgive me and cleanse me and take that away. He has made the provision for us to have salvation and to have life and life abundantly, just like we said, life abundantly. God meant it for good. Let's see what happened. Then he fell on his brother's, Benjamin's, neck and wept. And Benjamin wept on his neck. Moreover, he kissed all his brothers and wept over them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. He came and said, I'm your brother. I'm the one that you threw under the bus big time. Literally. Oh, well, a camel back then. Threw me under those camels, right? He said, I am the one. And he goes and falls on their neck and hugs them and kisses them. Man, when I repented of my sin, I could not believe that God Almighty would immediately, without blinking, he made the first move, right? He went to them first. He kissed all his brothers and wept over them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. Isn't that amazing? He came to us. He sought me out. And when I said, man, how can you be that forgiving of me? I told you before, the vision that I had where Jesus brought me to the Father and presented me to the Father. And here I was selling every drug known to man. I was committing every sin you could possibly dream of. I had every drug known to man in the other room that I was selling. And the Father immediately looked at me and said, I'll take him. And I said, you'll take me? I'm the scum of the earth, and you'll take me? He didn't even blink. He didn't think about it. He just said, I'll take you. I said, how can you do that with God Almighty? When he says it, it's true. I knew that he would take me, just like I am. And he had taken his brothers. And you could you do that to your brother or anyone else that had done the stuff that they did to him? Can you imagine? But yet, he goes and says, yes, I'm your brother, I love you, and come to me, please come to me, is what he said, please come to me. And they came and he grabbed them and starts hugging them and loving on them. Same thing that happened to me. I started getting sick and tired of my sin. I could not stand it anymore. I did not want to live that way any longer, but I couldn't get over it. I couldn't get the victory over my own sin. They couldn't either. They realized, hey, I'm the one that sinned here. That's why I'm suffering all this stuff. I'm the one that sinned here. And they went and said, ah, we come to you, O Joseph, when we bow the knee. We bow the knee. Isn't that amazing? Amen. But the forgiveness that he gave them. And then communion, that communication, that closeness where he is kissing all over them and weeping over them. And they talk with him. All of a sudden, there's that communion. There's that bringing together and coming together and saying, yes. Oh, man, you accept me. You forgive me for the stupid things that I've done, for the horrible way that I've treated you. And you forgive me and you bring me in. And you, now they have communion. Communion, and we get our word communication from that. They're talking with him and he's talking with them. Right? When we mess up, when we mess up, 1 John 1:8, if we say we have no sin in us, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Oh, take it away. And he comes immediately and falls on our neck and says, come. Look what happens next. Genesis 45:18. Joseph says, bring your father and your households and come to me. Go get everyone you know. Jesus, what Jesus saved you and your whole household shall be saved. Isn't that something? Does that sound anything familiar right there? Go bring your father and your households and come to me. I will give you the best of the land of Egypt and you will eat the fat of the land. Man. You come to me. Get everyone you know. Go tell everyone. First he said, come to me. Then now he says, go out. Get everyone you can. Bring everyone you know. Tell them to come to me too. Tell them to come to me. And I'll forgive them. And I will give you the best of the land of Egypt, and you will eat of the fat of the land. That, now that you know who I am, go into all the earth and bring in all who will come. You and your whole household shall be saved. Isn't that amazing? He does the same thing. How many times have we read over that and paid no attention to that? That's Old Testament stuff. And look at this. He says, also do not be concerned about your goods, for the best of all the land of Egypt is yours. Your goods. The Old King James, your stuff. Isn't that great? The Old King James, do not be concerned about your stuff. Forget about your stuff. You don't need the stuff. Where do we have our eyes on? All the stuff. You know? Yeah, we need a house. There's no question about that. Yeah, we need a vehicle in this day and age. People get around and all that sort of stuff. But we got our eyes on our stuff. Forget about all the stuff. For the best of all the land of Egypt is yours. All, everything in the world. Egypt is a type and shadow of the world. Everything here. Jesus says, come unto me, you already are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you. Right? And he's talking in context. Housing, clothing, food, everything we need here on this earth. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you. Forget about your stuff. Because, see, again, in this world, we're taught, make everything you can and hold on for dear life. Don't give anyone a dollar if they need it, you know. And you've got all this money. I said before, it's an honor. It's an amazing thing to see someone in need, and I have money to give. Hey, sure, no problem. I'm glad to do that. It's fun. That's the good part, because I'm not concerned about my stuff. Instead of the gimme, gimme, gimmes. The gimme, gimme, gimmes. Boy, if we got the bad case of the gimme, gimmes in this world and in this country. And that's why part of what this whole election that we're coming up on is all about. Who's going to give me the gimme, gimmes? You know, you got more gimme, gimmes? Well, let me vote for you then, but, you know. Don't be concerned about your stuff, because he has eternal life for you. He has given you everything that you could possibly want and desire. He shall supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. So what do we see in that story in comparison to today's story? We rejected him like they rejected him. They treated him badly. I rejected him. You rejected him. But God raised him up, just like Joseph raised him up to be ruler over all the known earth. And just like Jesus is now sitting at the right hand of the Father, he's raised him up. The world is at his feet. He says, sit on the throne until I make the whole world as your footstool. Amen? He's forgiven us our sins, cleansed the fallen righteousness if we come to him. And he wants us to be with him. Come to me. Come to me. I will keep you safe. Go and get your father and all your households and come, and I will take care of you here. I will feed you here. Kind of sounds like the rapture too, doesn't it? When the church leaves and when all the craziness is going on, all the famine was going on out there, right? All the famine was still going on outside. And they came in and they were going to eat of the fat of the land of Egypt. God took care of them. Sounds so much like the Word of God, where Jesus comes and takes his people aside while there's havoc going on the earth. He's going to take care of us and feed us and take care of us. He wants us to be with him. He wants us to be with him. But it is our option whether we say, yes, I want to be with you. I want to come into your presence. I want to fall on your neck as well. Let us communicate one to another. You know, he has given us everything that we need. He says, you have the best of all the land. He has given us everything that we need. But far too often, we don't appropriate those things. We don't make them our own. And there are parts of the Word of God that many, even Christians, reject. And we see denominations have arisen because of such things. There's division and strife. And they will say, well, I like this part of it, but I don't like this other stuff. That's kind of crazy stuff there. I don't want to be swinging from the chandeliers and stuff or anything like that. Like I said last week, we don't want to get crazy with this. I want to be a fanatic. Well, yeah, you kind of do. Because if you're missing out on something that God has, again, when I had my vision after he saved me, and it was like I took off on a rocket ride when Jesus came into me, and he said, wait, there's more. I went, what? There's more? Are you kidding me? But when God Almighty says there's more, what is there? There's more. Oh, you guys got this. I like this. But when God Almighty says there's more, then there's more. And he said to me, this is what he said to me. I was a Catholic, okay, again. He says, it's just more of me. It's important, and you're going to need it. This is important, and you're going to need it. And what he was talking about was the Holy Spirit. I needed the Holy Spirit of God in me. See, we can accept Jesus, but so many people reject the Holy Spirit. They don't want to have anything to do with that. That's a wild, you know, that's when people are speaking in tongues and everything, you know. Trying mocking the Word of God. Is it in the Word of God? Yes, it is. We are a full gospel church here because we don't reject or pick and choose parts of the Bible we want and reject the other. We don't do that. I'm not going to put God in a box and say, well, I'll take this, I'll take Jesus, but that Holy Spirit stuff, I don't want that. Guess what? That's the most important. Well, not the most important. Just as equally important. Let's put it that way. Equally as important, having Jesus in our hearts and living inside us, we need that Holy Spirit to lead us in all truth. Because if we don't, we all of a sudden our mind is not clear. See, the Holy Spirit will come in and lead us into all truth, is what Jesus says. He leads us into all truth. He leads us and gives us comfort in the midst of the trying times of this world. But it's a different thing. There's different people, right? God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I want all of it. I don't know about you. I want all of it. Amen. You want all of it?
Yes. Amen.
Good answer. Excellent answer.
Amen.
Because without part of what God Almighty has given us, Jesus says, I go to the Father, right? He's left. He's at the right hand of the Father. We just read the scripture a few minutes ago. He's at the right hand of the Father. But he says, but I'll leave a comforter with you. And he'll lead you into all truth. And that's the Holy Spirit. I'll leave the Holy Spirit to you. And he said, if anyone asks, I will freely give the Holy Spirit to anyone that asks. Man, how amazing. He wants me to. I was like, really? Okay. If it's from God, how can it be a bad thing? How can it be a bad thing? And see, sometimes we again, the enemy is very good at his job. I really wish he sucked at it, but he's really good at his job. And he tries to make it into a mockery. Oh, then you're going to talk in tongues and all that sort of stuff. Well, guess what? Does the Word of God talk about it? Yes, it does. And what it is you're praying the perfect prayer. I don't know if I should ask for this new job or this new car or whatever I need. I don't know what I should be asking, but it says that he prays the perfect prayer. Want to pray the perfect prayer? I want to pray the perfect prayer, you know what I mean? I think it's got to be right. If God Almighty is speaking through me straight to the Father and bypassing my big stupid brain, because I got a big stupid brain, well, ain't that big either. But if I can speak to God through me and praying the exact thing that Father wants, that he knows in his wisdom, is there for me. Oh, man. I can't mess it up. Again, that's why I came to the Lord. I can't screw it up if I'm doing what God Almighty has told me to do. Amen? I can't keep messing it up because I kept doing what I swore was the right thing to do. It's the wrong thing. Every time it was the wrong thing. But if I'm doing what God Almighty wants me to do, I cannot mess it up anymore. Same thing here. Now that we've come to his Son, he wants us to have his Holy Spirit as well. So come and receive his Holy Spirit. And he will give it, and he will give you peace. He will give you comfort. He will give you wisdom. He will reveal the things of God to us. Because the things of God are spiritually discerned, and we cannot discern them without the Spirit. They're spiritually discerned. We try and figure them out with our head. Because I don't want all that other stuff. That's scary. If it's from God, it ain't scary. God doesn't do anything scary. I don't like scary. He is God Almighty. So, as we close, if there be anyone here that would like to have everything that God's got for you, everything that God's got for you, I want it all. That's exactly what I said to him. I want it all. I want everything. Come. Come to the Father and say, oh Lord, give me your Holy Spirit. And your word says that you'll give it to me. And he also says that we have the evidence. We have evidence showing proof because we speak in a new language, just like the Word of God says. Just like Paul says, I speak in tongues more than any of you. But if I do it all without love, like I talked about a couple weeks ago or whenever it was, he will plant that love within us. So let's pray together. And then as we close, if there be anyone who would like to have the Holy Spirit working in your life to give you that victory, to give you that victory from the inside out, come up and we'll pray together. Amen. Father, we thank you so much for your word. Oh, Lord Jesus, for cleansing us and washing us in your word today, Lord God. Thank you for revealing your plan of salvation some 4,000 years ago through your servant. Oh, Lord Jesus, we open ourselves up to you. Thank you, Father, for breathing your life into us. Thank you for giving us your Son, Lord God. But we don't want to stop halfway, Lord. We want everything that you've got. So, Father, come. Wash us and cleanse us, Lord God. And now come, fill us with your Holy Spirit, Father. If it's of you, it's got to be amazing. And it will give us the victory over the things in our lives that has us in bondage. For we're in Shechem, we're in bonds, in chains, Lord God. And we need to be set free. We don't have the ability on our own, Father. Give us your Holy Spirit to lead us into all truth, Lord God, and into all righteousness, to give us the wisdom of God Almighty. We lay ourselves before your throne, Lord God, and we'll give you the glory and the honor in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. You know how to turn it off? Now, we got a couple of jugs of sweet tea if anyone's thirsty.